Hello guys, welcome to my channel. Once more is Ghana from Endless English. And today, we'll actually be talking about prepositions. Preposition is another part of a speech. And you know, we talked about nouns already. We talked about verbs. And then talked of a subject of a sentence. So if you haven't watched that lesson, so I'll put the link so you can watch that lesson. So before we begin, if you have any questions, please do go to the comment section and then send me your question. I'll be there waiting to answer you. So let's go. What's a preposition? First, we'll talk about what's a preposition. We'll talk about the types of preposition, how you'll be able to use preposition of time, preposition of place, preposition of direction, movement, preposition of agent. I mean, about preposition of time, we'll talk specifically about in, on, and at. You get my point when talking about time. So we'll talk about the various types, and then we'll have to finish this lesson with a quiz. We'll have to end the lesson with a quiz. So hope you are ready to go. So what's a preposition? Let's go. A preposition is a word that shows us the relationship between a noun or a noun phrase and other part of a sentence. Get my point? A preposition is a word that shows us the relationship between the noun or the noun phrase and the other part of a sentence. That's what the preposition is. So what are the various types of prepositions that we have in English? First, we'll talk about preposition of time. We'll also talk about preposition of place. We'll talk about preposition of direction or movement. We'll talk about preposition of agent. We'll talk about preposition of instrument, device, machine, or joint, instrument, device, machine. Preposition of reason or purpose. Preposition of connection. Preposition of origin. Get my point? So these are the various types of prepositions that we have in English. So to quickly go on, what's a preposition of time? Preposition of time is a word that shows us the relationship of time between the noun and the other part of the sentence. So I'll best explain this by using three preposition words. Get my point? I'll use in, on, and at to best describe what's a preposition of time. So what's a preposition of time when using in? So we use in when talking about a preposition of time in the following three instances. We have three instances that we use in when talking about preposition of time. No, three instances. First, we have when we're talking about a month or a year. When we're talking about a month or a year, we'll use in. For example, for each of them, I'll give you an example. For example, when talking about a month, using in, we can say, for example, in March, in September, in December, in August, that's a month. That's when we're talking about time. Using in, the preposition of time, in. In regards to time, we'll talk about a month. Referring to a month, we use in December, in August, in September, in January. That's when talking about a month. We also use in when talking about a year. Hope you get my point. When talking about a year, when talking about a month, when talking about a year, for example, we have in 2005, in 2020, in 2018. Those are various years. So when talking about year, we use in. When talking about month, we use in. Note. And the second instance, when we use in, is at particular times. At particular times of the day, particular times of the month, particular times of the year. You get my point? This is the second instance when we'll be using in. We'll talk about particular times of the day, particular times of the month, and particular times of the year. So let's take the first example, particular times of the day. We'll talk about an example is in the evening. In the evening. Because evening is a particular time. You get my point? In the morning. That's a particular time. In the evening, in the morning. Those are examples when using in talking about particular time of the day. Let's give an example for particular times of the month. Particular times of the month. We'll talk about the third week. We can just say in the third week of March, in the fourth week of September, in the first week of January. Those are particular times of the month. First, fourth, third week. Those are particular times of the month. We use in there. We also use in when talking about particular times of the year. You have in winter. You don't say at or on winter. You say in winter, in summer. You get my point? In winter, in summer. Those are particular times of the year because after summer, you have another season. Summer is a particular season of the year. Winter is also a particular season of the year. You get my point? So that's when we use in. Talk about particular times of the day, particular times of the month, and particular times of the year. We also use in when talking about a century. This is the third instance. Remember, we talked about month and year, particular times of the day, month and year. Then this is the third instance we are talking about here. A century or specific time in the past or in the future. A century or specific times in the past or in the future. For example, when talking of a century, we can say in the 21st century, we are in the 21st century now. In the 21st century. You don't say maybe on or at a 21st century. You say in the 21st century because that's a century. And when using preposition of time, in is required. You get my point? That's when talking about century. We can also talk of specific time in the past or in the future. To give you an example, in the early days of this company, in the early days means the olden days. In the early days means at first, at the beginning days of the company. So when talking about the past, you use in to talk about specific times in the past. You also use in for future. You can say in the future, in 10 years to come, in 15 years to come. That's the future. You get my point? In the future, we use in. So we've talked about the first instance, month and year. We've talked about particular times of day, month and year. And we've talked about a century specific time in the past or in the future. Those are the three instances that we use in when referring to preposition of time. Those are the three instances. And how do we use on? When talking about preposition of time, we have that three instances that we use on when talking about preposition of time. You get my point? Hope you understand. First, we'll talk about a day. Then we'll talk about a date. Get my point? A day. We'll talk about a date. Then we'll talk about particular days. When we talk about a day, when referring to preposition of time, on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, that's when you are using on to refer to a preposition of time. You use on for a day, for a date, and for particular days. Hope you understand. For a day, we have an example on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday. That's when we are using on for days. When we are talking of date, you can say on the 7th of February, on the 7th of March, on the 10th of December. we use on when referring to day. When talking about preposition of time and using on, we talk about dates. Talk about days, date. And in particular days. An example, when talking about particular days, we can say, on the emperor's birthday, on my birthday, on the Independence Day. Those are all particular days. Because the imperial has a birthday, I have a birthday, the Independence Day is maybe on a particular day, particular days. So we also have three instances when using on to refer to preposition of time. We talk about days, we talk about date, and then on particular days. On each of them, I've given an example. On Monday, example for day. For date, we can say on the 7th of February. For particular days, on the Emperor's birthday, on the Independence Day, we use on. We don't use in or at when referring to this category. When referring to these days or dates or particular days. So let's talk about at. We use at to talk about times of a clock and short and specific times. I'll give an example for time of a clock. At 4 o'clock, at 5 o'clock, at 6 a.m., that's in the morning, at 6 p.m. in the evening. So we use at when talking about times of a clock, we use at. We also use at when talking about short and precise time. For example, at bedtime, that's just before going to bed, you know. At lunchtime, the period when eating. At lunchtime, that's a period, that's a specific and precise period when having lunch. Maybe from 12 to 1, that interval, we use at lunchtime, at bedtime. Can say meet me at bedtime, get me? So, those are the instances that we use in, on, and at when referring to preposition of time. Hope you understand. If you do have any questions on this, please don't hesitate to ask me on the comment section and I'll be there to answer you. So let's look at the next preposition. Preposition of place. What's a preposition of place? A preposition of place describes a place that a person or a thing is located. A preposition of place, note, describes a place that a person or a thing is located. And still, I'll use these three preposition words to explain better. In, at, on, because they're just three prepositions of place. But they can be used in different ways. But note that three prepositions of place. So first, we use in. When talking about preposition of place, when referring to a place having a physical or virtual boundary, a place having some sort of a physical or having a boundary, you know, that can be seen or that has been demarcated, we use in. For example, we can say in the car. In the car. A car has a specific portion that it covers. Outside that portion, it's not a car. A car has a door. I mean, has doors that once you go out of that door, maybe that's not a car. That's no longer a car. That's not longer in the car. Get my point? So we can talk of in the car. We can talk of in the building, the particular building, talk of in the building, in the hall, in the library. Library is a particular place, maybe with books and a place to read, in the library. That's when we use in, referring to a preposition of place. Get me? We use at, we use at when referring to specific places and points. We use at when referring to specific places and points. I beg your pardon, just a little mix up here. You get my point? So we use at when referring to specific places and points. For example, I'll give an example. When referring to specific places and points, using at to refer to prepositions of place, we can say at the bus stop. At the bus stop. The bus stop is a particular place. It's a marketed place that the bus has to come, stop the people alight or people get into the bus, you know, and then the bus takes off. That's a particular place, the bus stop. We can talk of the edge, at the edge of a roof, at the edge of a roof. The edge of a roof is a, you have a roof and then you have a point that the roof ends. That's when you talk about at specific places and points, at the edge of the table, at the edge of anything, at a specific point. Get my point? That's when we use at the bus stop, at the edge of the roof. That those are examples when we use at referring to preposition of place. Then we'll talk about on. When do we use on when referring to preposition of place? We use on to talk about surfaces of objects. We use on when referring to surfaces of things, surfaces of objects, surfaces of, I mean, anything. I give you an example. On the table is there, the surface of the table. On the table, this is the table. On the chair, the surface, you know, the part you're sitting on. The surface on the chair, on the floor, the surface floor. Those are surface of things. That's when we use on, when referring to surface of things. So we've talked about surface preposition of place, when, how we can use in, at, on, when referring to preposition of place. In places with physical boundaries. For example, in a building, at specific places or points, at the bus stop, at the edge of the roof, you know. We've talked about on, when referring to surfaces of things, on the table, on the chair, on the map, specific point on the map. Map is a surface, is maybe on the paper, and then the map is there, the surface of the paper. That's when we use on. So for you to better communicate well in English, you need to master the way in, on, at, and use when referring to preposition of place, because they're quite different, you see. And then we'll talk about the next preposition, direction, preposition of direction and movement. This preposition is a preposition that actually expresses the movement or direction of an object, of a person or an object. It describes or expresses the direction or movement of an object or a person. We have some prepositions here, preposition of directions here. We have to, into, through, towards, etc. These are prepositions of direction. I'll give an example with maybe two of them. Towards, for example, the snake was coming towards me. When the snake has to come towards you, you have to maybe escape and stuff like that, you know. So the snake was coming towards me. The towards here is a preposition of direction. It shows us the direction that the snake was coming, the direction. It tells us towards me, towards the noun. It expresses the direction or movement of a person or an object. was coming towards me, the snake was coming towards me, showing in this direction. Another example is the cat went through the pipe. The cat went through the pipe. The cat went through shows the direction in which the cat went. You know, the verb is go here. The cat had to go in a certain direction, and the direction here is indicated by through. That's the pipe is there, and then inside and pass through the pipe. Through the pipe. Those are two examples when using through and towards, talking about direction, preposition of direction, and movement. You know my point? So let's go to the next preposition. We have the next preposition. Preposition of agent. Preposition of agent. What was this one talking about even? Preposition of agent describes a person or a thing causing or has caused something to happen. Get my point? A preposition of agent describes a person or a thing that has caused or is causing something to occur. So we have various prepositions here. Most of the times this will be used with a passive voice. Passive voice English, we'll still cover that. So we have some prepositions of agent here. We have by and with. So I'll give you an example using by and using with. You know, describing a person or a thing causing or has caused an action. The student was hit by a car. The student was hit by a car. The student was hit by a car shows the agent that caused the action. The agent that caused the action is car, by the car. So this preposition tells us, describes to us the person or thing causing or that has caused, the person or thing that caused or that is causing something to occur. In this case, the car is the one causing or has caused the action. The student was hit by a car. You get my point? So we've talked about agent and we've talked about an example here using by. So let's go to the next. Preposition of instrument, device, and machine. A preposition of instrument, device, and machine just describes the ways in which technology is used, the ways in which devices are used, describes the ways in which machines are used. Note here that when we use by to talk about preposition of instrument or device or machine, when we use by, we're talking about the mode of transport. We're talking about the mode of transport. Because you have by, with, on, these are preposition of device. So for example, if we use by when referring to preposition of device, machine, instrument, we'll talk about by car. I went to school by car. Means the mode of transport to school was using a car, by car. Means I went by a vehicle. You get my point? That's the case when using by. So with and on describe the use of machines and devices, with and on. So I give you an example here. We have an example using with. I break the wall with a hammer. I break the wall with a hammer tells us the hammer is the device that we use to break the wall, is the device we use here. That's why with is a preposition of instrument. We can use it as a preposition of instrument here. With a hammer, I break the wall with a hammer to actually bring the wall down. Using a hammer, with a hammer means we use a hammer. Describes the use of a device here. With. Get my point? So we talk about the next. The next type of preposition we have here is a preposition for reason or purpose. A preposition of reason or purpose. This one tells us preposition of reason or purpose tells us or describes to us why something is occurring or will occur. Why something is occurring or will occur. Understand? Why something is occurring or will occur is a preposition of purpose. We have, for example, some prepositions of reason or purpose. We have for, true, because of, for, true, because of. These are all prepositions of reason or purpose. You know? For example, using for to talk about preposition of reason, I can say, I did that for you. I did all that for you. Means it's because of you, for your sake, that I had to do that. You are the reason that I had to do that. The purpose of doing that was for you. That's just a statement. I did all that for you. You know? That's when talking about preposition of purpose and using for. We can see, using because of, we can have another example like, because of the traffic, I was late for work. Because of the traffic, I was late for work. Because it's telling us there that the reason for my lateness to work is because of traffic. The reason is traffic. Because of traffic, this preposition because of is describing the reason why I'm late to work. Because of traffic is the reason I'm late for work. You get me? That's when talking about preposition for reason or purpose. Then we have preposition for connection. That theory case is here. Preposition for connection. When talking about preposition for connection, we have three cases. You know, we have relationship, we have accompaniment, and we have possession. We have relationship, we have possession, and we have accompaniment. These are three cases when talking about preposition of connection. And each of them has a preposition you have to use when talking about each of these subsections. When talking about preposition of connection, we have a case of possession, we have a case of relationship, and we have a case of accompaniment. Let's take an example of each of them. Let's talk about possession first. We can see an example using of when talking about preposition of possession. We can say the statue of independence, the statue, take for this case unity, the statue of unity is located in India. The statue of unity is located in India. The possession here, the statue possesses, the sign of unity. The statue of unity is located in India. The statue here possesses the sign. If you see the statue, you know that's the sign of unity. That's why it uses of. When talking about preposition of connection and talking about possession, you have to use of. We have given an example. The statue of unity is located in India. We can say the Statue of Liberty is located in New York, in America. The Statue of Liberty, in this case, is located in America. The Statue of Unity is located in India. Those are cases when talking about preposition of possession. Because once you see any of those statues, it signifies either unity or liberty. You get my point? So let's go to the next subsection, when talking about preposition of connection and dealing with relationship. We have to use to. Yeah, we have to use to. It's a rule. So I give an example when talking about preposition of connection to refer to relationship. You know? This is an example. Can you say a well-written essay is impressive to teachers. A well-written essay is impressive to teachers. A well-written essay is impressive to teachers. Means, when teachers see a nicely written essay, I mean, it gets them to be impressed. It moves them to be impressed. So we have to use two in this case. A well-written essay is impressive to teachers. The relationship between essay and teachers, the relationship, a well-written essay, the relationship of a well-written essay and teachers. A well-written essay is impressive to teachers. That's the case when we use preposition of connection and talking about relationship. Then we have the last preposition of connection when talking about accompaniment. We have to use with in this case. You cannot use of, you cannot use to, or whatever. You have to use with. I give you an example. Maki wanted to go to the concert with Cherry. Maki is a person who wanted to go, wants to go to the concert with Cherry. With Cherry means Cherry accompanying Maki to go to the party. Hope you're getting my point. When we talk about prepositions of connection referring to accompaniment, we have to use with. I've just given an example. Maki wanted to go to the concert with Cherry. With here means accompanying together to the concert. So these are the cases when talking about preposition of connection. I have to talk about possession. We're giving an example. We have also given an example of relationship accompaniment. You know, so possession, we talked of the statue of unity located in India. Relationship, we gave an example of an essay, a well-written essay, is impressive to teachers. That's an example of relationship. When using preposition of connection referring to relationship. And we also gave an example for accompaniment. Maki wanted to go to the concert with Cherry. Together with Cherry, accompanying Cherry. And the last preposition we have here is preposition of origin. Preposition of origin, that's the last preposition we have here. So when English speakers talk of a person's origin, a person's nationality, a person's hometown, a person's ethnicity, or where something was designed or manufactured, then we use from. Get my point? When English speakers talk of a person's origin, a person's nationality or ethnicity, or a person's hometown, or where a product or something was designed or manufactured, then we use from. We use from. The preposition of origin we use in this case for a person's origin or where a product or something was designed or manufactured, we use from. And yet, to a lesser extent, to a very, tiny extent, little extent, we use of. You get my point? To a very lesser extent, we use of. So English speakers often use from, and to a lesser extent, use of. So I'll give an example when talking about preposition of origin, when talking about someone's origin. For example, I'll give an example starting with from. For example, I can say, I saw the nice couple from Italy. I saw the nice couple from Italy. Here the statement shows that the couple, the married people, are from Italy. You get my point? I saw the married couple from Italy. I can give another example still with from. For example, I am from New York, but I live in Maryland. I am from New York, but I live in Maryland. That statement shows that I come from, that's my place of origin. Maybe I'm not there at the moment, but that's my place of origin. Maybe that's where I was born or that's where I grew up. But then at the point of speaking, I am no longer at that place. I'm no longer at New York. You get my point? So when talking of a person's origin, where a person comes from, a person's nationality, a person's ethnicity, we use from most of often. So I'll give another example using of. Remember I said earlier, to a very lesser extent, we use of. I'll give an example using of. For example, using of, using the preposition of origin, using, giving an example, using of. The lecturer is of Turkish descent. The lecturer is of Turkish descent. Means the lecturer's nationality, where the lecturer is coming from, is Turkey. The lecturer is of Turkish descent. That's an example using of. You know, this is a preposition of origin to tell us where someone or somebody is coming from, or where a product or a good or something was designed or manufactured. Example, when using from to talk about it, something that was designed, we can say the new computer from the giant tech firm is groundbreaking. The new computer, that's an example when using from. The new computer from the giant tech firm is groundbreaking. The new computer from the giant tech firm is groundbreaking. Means maybe the sales are too high. The computer from. You cannot see the computer at. The computer from, because it was designed by that tech company. The computer from the giant tech firm is groundbreaking. So with this, if you have any question, I repeat, if you feel like you have difficulties understanding this, or there's a particular part where you can't really get, I mean, the understanding perfectly, feel free to ask me a question in the comment section below and I'll be there to answer you. So with this, I want us to now go to the quiz. You know, I said earlier that we'll end with a quiz. So now is the quiz. So what I want you guys to do is pause the video. Get my point? Pause the video. And then once you've decided your answers, once you've had your answers, then you can continue the video to see the right answers, to see the ones you got correctly and the ones you got wrongly. That's to see the ones you got correctly and those that you, I mean, didn't get correctly. Get my point? Pause the video, decide your answers, then continue the video to see the answers. Get my point? So now, quiz. And now, answers. So, wow, guys. Truly, we have come to the end of this lesson. And truly, I want to thank you guys for being with me through this lesson. I mean, for following me through this lesson. And I want to tell you, it's been a pleasure, wonderful pleasure, being your teacher. Once more, don't forget, it's Ghana from Endless English. And if you found this lesson important, if you found this lesson interesting, if you loved this lesson, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for all updates and videos regarding this channel. As always, this is how it's done. And this is the way it's supposed to be done. Until next time, from me and my team, it's a goodbye for now. Bye bye.